Hey, I'm James, and today I'm going to discuss the temporomandibular joint. I will start by discussing the associated bones and some important landmarks. I will then discuss the joint itself, and then the muscles of mastication. Finally, I will discuss jaw dislocation and how this is resolved. Make sure to subscribe to be the first to know when we release new videos. To understand the TMJ and the muscles of mastication, we must first consider the bones and the associated bony landmarks. The bones to consider are the temporal bone, the sphenoid bone, the zygomatic bone, the maxilla, and the mandible. So let's start with the mandible. The mandible has two superior processes, the condyloid process and the coronoid process, and between we have the mandibular notch. Moving inferiorly, we have the neck, the ramus, and the angle. Anteriorly, the body is located here, just lateral to that of the mental foramina, which we can see here and here. The mental nerves exit here and provide sensory innervation to the chin and some of the mandibular teeth. The mental nerves are branches of the inferior alveolar nerve and consequently the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve. The mandibular foramina and submandibular fossa are located on the internal aspect of the mandible. The submandibular gland is pushed up against the fossa, whereas the inferior alveolar nerve enters into the mandibular canal here via the mandibular foramen. So let's now focus on the temporal bone. The point at which the condyloid process of the mandible articulates with the temporal bone is at the mandibular fossa. When the jaw is lowered, it is limited anteriorly by the articular tubercle here, or sometimes known as the articular eminence, which is a portion of the zygomatic arch. Posteriorly, we can see the external auditory meatus, and posterior inferior to that of the mandibular fossa is the mastoid process. Just for completeness, we can see the styloid process here. So now with the mandible back in with the model, we can talk about the temporomandibular joint. The TMJ is a synovial joint at the articulation between the condyloid process of the mandible and the mandibular fossa of the temporal bone, in a region known as the infratemporal fossa. The joint includes an articular disc that splits the TMJ into an upper compartment and a lower compartment, and this is the articular disc here. Gliding movements are permitted in the upper compartment, such as protrusion and retraction, as well as side-to-side movements. In the lower compartment, rotational movements occur, such as elevation and depression. Depression of the jaw will only occur once the condyloid process has moved anteriorly within the upper compartment here. The movement is limited anteriorly by the articular tubercle, which we can see on the model. The TMJ will be dislocated if the condyloid process moves beyond the articular tubercle. The TMJ is surrounded by a joint capsule, which we can see here, and is further supported by some extracapsular ligaments. The lateral temporomandibular ligament, which we can see here, attaches to the zygomatic arch and the posterior portion of the neck of the mandible. This ligament limits posterior movements of the mandible. The medial ligaments include the sphenomandibular ligament and the stylomandibular ligament, both of which limit lateral movements. The sphenomandibular ligament runs from the ramus of the mandible to the sphenoid bone, and the stylomandibular ligament runs from the ramus of the mandible to the styloid process. Now I'll move on to the muscles of mastication. The pterygoid muscles are located medial to the mandible. The medial pterygoid muscle has two heads, a deep head and a superficial head. The deep head is attached to the medial aspect of the lateral pterygoid plate, which is approximately here. The superficial head attaches to the maxilla as well as the palatine bones. Both heads run posterior inferiorly to reach a point in which they fuse approximately here. This fused muscle will then insert onto the ramus of the mandible, which we can see here. The lateral pterygoid is best seen on a lateral view of the model. So to see the pterygoids, we must first remove the ramus of the mandible here. So now with the ramus removed, we can see the superficial head of the medial pterygoid muscle. Up here, we can see the lateral pterygoid muscles with a superior head and an inferior head here. The superior head attaches to the roof of the infratemporal fossa, as well as the lateral portion of the lateral pterygoid plates here. The inferior head attaches to the lateral portion of the lateral pterygoid plates. Moving posteriorly, both heads will fuse and will attach to the condyloid process of the mandible, located approximately here. When the lateral pterygoid muscles act bilaterally, they protrude the jaw. This movement is paramount to the opening of the mouth. Unilateral contraction swings the jaw to the contralateral side. Bilateral action of the medial pterygoid muscles close the jaw and will also assist in protrusion. Unilateral contraction will swing the jaw to the contralateral side. The fan-shaped temporalis muscle arises from the temporal fossa, located here, and the fibers attach onto the coronoid process of the mandible, located here. The anterior fibers run vertically and will assist in closing the jaw. The posterior horizontal fibers, which we can see here, will retract the mandible. The masseter muscle is located on the lateral side of the mandible, just here. It has two heads, a superficial head and a deep head. The attachments are the zygomatic bone and the zygomatic arch, which we can see. Both muscles slope inferiorly to then attach onto the ramus and angle of the mandible here. This muscle elevates the mandible to close the mouth. All of the muscles of mastication are innervated by the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve. The jaw is most stable when it is closed and the teeth are in occlusion. Anterior dislocation is the most common form of displacement. Anterior dislocation is opposed by the articular tubercle, the lateral ligament, and a contraction of medial pterygoid, masseter, and temporalis. However, in the instance of anterior dislocation, the condyloid process moves anterior to the articular process, and the muscles of mastication spasm, the combination of which prevents retraction of the mandible. This spasm must be overcome by putting downward pressure on the inferior molars and then guiding the head of the mandible back into the mandibular fossa. So just a quick summary. The temporomandibular joint is a synovial joint formed by the articulation of the condyloid process of the mandible and the mandibular fossa of the temporal bone. An articular disc sits within the joint, which creates an upper and lower cavity. The upper cavity allows for gliding movements, whereas the lower cavity allows for rotational movements. The muscles of mastication act on the joint. The TMJ is most stable when the jaw is closed. We'd love to hear your feedback on what you've thought of this video and what topics you'd like us to cover in the future. You can do this by leaving a comment or dropping us an email.